Hello, everyone, and welcome to this next edition of BOC Group's 2020 Enterprise Architecture Impact Series. The topic of today's session is leveraging the power of enterprise architecture for seamless mergers and acquisitions at Apex Funds. My name is Michael Kambroff. I'm an enterprise architecture consultant for the BOC Group, and I'll be your host for today. So once again, welcome to today's session. And without any further ado, I would also like to introduce our presenter, Derek Black, Chief Enterprise Architect and the leader of Apex Funds' enterprise architecture practice. Derek, thank you for joining us today. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much. As Michael said, my name is Derek Black. I'm going to be presenting today on leveraging the power of enterprise architecture. So yeah, just a bit of history and story on who I am, where I come from. I've been involved in IT for many, many years now. I've almost lost count. I started off as a developer and quickly repented of that and got into infrastructure after that. Quickly repented of that again. I found that most of the problems to an awful lot of the IT systems could be solved at the design stage. And so I started to get into solution architecture, and it was solution architecture both from an applications and also from an infrastructure point of view, because I kind of had a foot in both of those camps. And so as I'd started to gain expertise in different types of solutions, I eventually realized that most of the problems within IT could be solved at the enterprise architecture level. So when I started my career in enterprise architecture, I certified in TOGAF, and that seems to be one of the global standards out there. Not that it's necessarily the best for every situation, but it represents an agreed framework. And if anything, an agreed framework gives us a common vocabulary and terminology so that we can refer to the same ideas. So I spent a lot of time across a lot of different industries, mainly in financials though. So I've been in fintech for probably the last 10 years, I'd say, and I'm currently working with a company called Apex Fund Services as the global enterprise architect. This has had specific challenges. I'll tell you a little bit more about Apex. Apex, we've been in business now for 15 years. And it's in what's called the fund administration business. So if anybody knows anything about fund administration or even hedge funds, maybe you've heard of those. Basically, it's a very small group of qualified investors, i.e. very rich people who have money to do things with. And they generally put them into these specialist funds. These funds then, obviously, they trade stocks and bonds and other securities as well. And our job as fund accountants is to give the fund managers the key financial data that they need to make decisions. So we do all of their accounting for them. The core responsibility is something called a net asset valuation. So on a monthly basis, what we'll do is we'll produce these net asset valuations, basically looking at the previous NAV and calculating how much all of those investments were worth. And then we do it all again the next month, and we highlight any ups or downs or movements in the various equities. So there's an awful lot of calculation and financial reporting that we have to do. Not only that, but as you can see from this slide, we have just over 500 billion in assets under administration. So these are all the assets that we administer. More than 3,000 staff worldwide, over 40 locations, 26 jurisdictions, and in 20 languages. So the asset classes that we mainly deal with would be private equity, real estate, and obviously hedge and hybrid funds. But we also do family office, fund of funds, mutuals, and managed accounts as well. We augment that as well with middle office, banking and depository, and then corporate services too. So just to give you an idea of the global reach of all of these funds, where we're domiciled and where we administer from, this is kind of a very brief story of the major acquisitions that we have conducted over the past probably 2 years. I've been with Apex now for over 2 years now. And just to give you a bit of background, I was brought in originally, I was brought in back in December, I think it's 2017, 2018 actually. And Apex had just acquired a division of Deutsche Bank, the alternate fund services for Deutsche Bank. So they were doing exactly what we do, except they were doing it under the umbrella of Deutsche Bank. And when we were originally there, we started off with a very, very small IT team. There was only four of us sitting together. I was hot desking with the COO at that stage. So we had the CTO, the CIO, the TDA, who's also a system administrator, and we had a couple of development guys too. But that was it. Now we're over 150 strong on the IT team alone, which just kind of testifies to the scale of this change. After we had done the major integration of the Deutsche Bank alternate fund services, we then went off and bought a company in Luxembourg called Warburg. And we also then bought LRI and IPES, followed by Custom House, and then a division of Link, CPSC, followed by Beacon, and then Atlantic. And there's a couple of others that aren't on this, but we've since acquired them. So in total, we have acquired 13 different businesses over the course of 2 years. And the challenge for me as enterprise architect is to look at these companies, look at their IT landscape, their application information architecture, and to fold it into our existing architecture. So that's really what this presentation is about, is the challenges that I've had doing that and how I've overcome those. And obviously enterprise architecture is the key to that. So these are some of the services that we offer. There's fund administration. So under fund administration, you can see there that you've got the daily, weekly, monthly fund accounting. So that's the value of the funds, the NAVs and things like that. Corporate services. So the corporate services would be reporting to the local regulators, filing any corporate paperwork and any of the corporate accounting that needs to happen with that. Then there's banking and depository. This came with the Warburg integration. Because of the funds that we were administering, we wanted to add capabilities. So we bought a bank, and that's basically what Warburg was. It was a small private investment bank that was used to deposit securities into and take account of them, and also help to alleviate regulator concerns with cross-contamination, checking your own homework, things like that. But in addition to that, we have different platforms that we do risk reporting, fund platform, onshoring, things like that. Those are all complementary, as well as the middle office services. So the EFT middle office is the actual trading desk, so to speak. So we've done that. The technologies used to do all of this obviously plays a huge part in what we offer. And one of the key differentiators that I think Apex Fund Services offer is a number of different platforms that you can go onto. Normally, when you go with a fund administrator, you're kind of tied into their system. So our competitive advantage is that we can offer different platforms for accounting, delivery, reporting, security, fraud, detection analysis, things like that. So if you have a fund in one particular platform, we could administer it in that platform as well because we offer this. That was a difficult enough challenge because obviously from an IT point of view, we've got a number of different acquisitions and we have to consolidate on platforms and make sure that we have good uniform offering across the board. So the key technologies here would be things like FIS. eFront, currently a product that we're using as well, and that's mainly for private equity. We also have Geneva, which is a general ledger system that mainly does for open-ended, UCITS types of funds. So these are the typical hedge funds with stocks and bonds and things like that. The structure of each of these funds is extremely important because we need different products for or different platforms for different products. So that's always been a difficult, that's always been a challenge for us, being able to offer those platforms and offer those products in a way that the consumer and the customer could most readily and easily access. We need to make it publicly available so that they can get data whenever they want it, but it also has to integrate to a certain extent with their own systems, their risk analysis or their AML, KYC solutions, things like that. So these are the key platforms that we offer, but that we also need to make seamless for them too. Investment Cafe is a very important one. That's kind of a front end so that they can go and they can get their own reports, get a history of the reports that we've given them. Alta Return as well is for private equity. Yardi is another one. Fundrec is extremely important. The ID Register is very important for due diligence, KYC, FATCA, and investor reporting. That's heavily used, as well as Metrosoft. We use that again to look for PEPs and really augments our KYC ability. And finally, Viewpoint there is used for our corporate secretarial. So those are the key technology platforms that we have. Now, if you'll notice here, as a result of our integrations, this is a slightly dated slide because we've added more stacks to our platform, but each one of those columns represents a different business and the technology stack that that business sits upon. So a lot of that's going to be the infrastructure. So we'll have some of them that use Lotus Notes as their email. Others use on-prem Microsoft Outlook. Others use the Office 365 in the cloud. And so one of the challenges is to try to consolidate all this infrastructure into a common platform. That's not even going near the applications yet. From file system distributed across the globe to desktops, sitting on desktops in different office locations, getting the network in place for that, being able to communicate across the WAN. We've got several separate WANs. Also, just to give you, provide a word of warning here, we haven't completely integrated all this stuff. This is always an ongoing operation. It doesn't look like that anymore. This is always something in flow. Really, my job was to look at all these different platforms. And after the Deutsche Bank integration, after we learned all our lessons from that, one of the key things that I had to do was set up almost an enterprise architecture pipeline and a framework in which we could categorize and model and make sure to effectively migrate an awful lot of that infrastructure and consolidate it, replatform it onto our own shared offering. So each one of those, as you can see, has a different function. It's a different color because it's involved in a different stack and also supports different businesses. So those are the different technology stacks that we currently have in Apex. So what are the challenges? There are plenty of challenges. Timelines is a huge one. Generally, the CEO would publish a timeline, for example, for the Deutsche Bank acquisition. He says, we're going to ingest, we're going to integrate Deutsche Bank within 6 months. So a lot of these timelines are also driven by regulatory, which we don't have there right now, but we have regulatory concerns here. So when one fund administrator or anything in the financial industry, if we're talking about mergers and acquisitions, it usually has to be approved by the jurisdiction in which that acquisition has taken place. So, for example, in Luxembourg, we have the CSSF, which is the financial regulator there. They would look at the merger and acquisition, they would look at the structures of the businesses, and obviously their goal is to protect the end user, the client, the investor. And what they want to do is they want to make sure that nothing is lost in that. So frequently, not just as a part of the legal and operational aspects of this, but they'll look very heavily at the technology that's involved and how we're going to not only safely get that over there, but also secure that information once we have it. So that's always a big problem. And they usually look at timelines and they'll ask you obviously to stick to those timelines. And sometimes approval is based on you being able to hit fairly aggressive timelines as well. So even though I spent a bit of time on that timeline, it's hugely, hugely important, which means that we need to be as slick as possible when we're doing this. The business capability integration as well. We have, 13 different businesses, which means we have 13 different ways of fund accounting, and not all of those are the same. They don't use the same methods. They don't use the same technologies, and so we'll have 13 different ways of doing the same thing effectively, from purely spreadsheet based to integrated, fully automated applications. So it's those business capabilities and bringing them under the same umbrella, the same hierarchy, that become extremely important. In a lot of cases, we have to rip out this particular entity from a parent entity. So for example, when we had the CSPC acquisition, that was part of a broader group of Link. When we did the Deutsche Bank integration, that was a part of the broader Deutsche Bank organization. Custom House was the same thing. So sometimes when you're doing that, an awful lot of the parent entity will control a lot of shared services. So we have to separate them from their shared services, like email, file system, help desk, things like that. And we have to try to switch that over to our shared services as well. Obviously, the legal and compliance data, we have to take all the historical data in some instances, and we have to move that. So it's very large data volumes there, any historical reports, financial records. We have to look at the compliance aspects of that, find out how long we need to keep it and how we're going to get it over. And then finally, ironically, the branding, email, websites and things like that is usually the least difficult of all of those. The data transfer obviously is huge. We have to deal with usually terabytes of data from financial records and transactions going back 10, 15 years sometimes. We also have client novation as well. The clients have to, in most instances, have to give the express written consent for their account to be transferred to the Apex Group. And that always presents problems because sometimes you have to carve out a specific account in case they don't want to come under the Apex Group umbrella. We usually let legal deal with that, but that's one of the constraints. Obviously, we have client and regulatory queries that we have to deal with, give them a detailed breakdown of how we secure their data, how we plan on meeting our regulatory requirements as well. And not quite necessarily last, but certainly not least, there's the application integration. That's where we spend probably most of our time, is with this application integration piece. And then finally, the platform compatibility. When you have emails and notes and emails and Outlook, it's how do we pull those out and how do we combine them? The business challenges, as you can see here, I've just taken a very brief snapshot of the different types of business functions that each company will provide and how they're related to those entities as well. So what I've done is I've actually modeled this in Addo IT, and we've got different swim lanes for the different companies. And what we did is we'll sit back from a very high level and we'll say, okay, what does this business do? What do they specialize in? We'll model their business capabilities. And so as you can see there, Apex, we have fund accounting, transfer agency, corporate services. And then obviously this is a very simplified one, but we get very, very detailed in a lot of these too. And we can dissect by jurisdiction, because the way that they do corporate services in Ireland is not necessarily the way that they do it in Luxembourg, and it's not necessarily the way they do it in the United States. So we deconstruct all of those down to the business process level. It's one of the very first things that we do. IPES is a really good example. And as you can see here, this comes from a roadmap or a phased basis. So you can see the different corporate functions that we anticipate on addressing and what we're going to be doing. So you can see that we're actually going to be getting rid of all those. And there's a slide later on that I'll show you. It kind of looks a little bit at the migration of those. Let's go on to the next one here. This is a really good example of the corporate functions. So Apex FA and TA and the different applications that these functions depend on. This is where we make our money. This is absolutely crucial to be able to map out exactly which business functions are dependent on which applications. And then we have two different teams. We have the business teams, the operation teams, who make sure that the business processes and the business functions, the business capabilities are being integrated. And then also at the back end, we have a fairly extensive technology team who are working on mapping out the applications and how they're integrated, the integration points as well, the interfaces, the technologies behind those interfaces, how much traffic, how chatty it is, things like that. But all of this has to go into the discovery piece. So this is a really good map and absolutely crucial. These types of reports that we have that map these business functions, how these business functions depend on each other and how those business functions depend on the applications. So those are crucial. It's very useful because we can double click on each one of those applications. We can get a whole host of reports on that application and any other links that application may have. For example, Geneva, we know the architecture behind Geneva. We know the interfaces that we have to take into account. We know the different modules that comprise Geneva as well and what those modules and technologies depend on. Next one here, obviously the answer to all of this is enterprise architecture. So that's probably the key thing that I'll be addressing here is how enterprise architecture actually helps to streamline this, helps to speed it along. And I can tell you right now, it's a very, very difficult job. Even when you have predefined templates, you know what your steps are going to be, it's still very difficult to adapt and to modify those processes to the speed of transformation that is required by the business. That's absolutely crucial. There are compromises that we have to make sometimes, but overall, it really goes into a risk register and the business has to pick which of those compromises they think are worth it, which ones are not. So obviously, one of the very first things that I did right after the Deutsche Bank integration, it was kind of a rush, rush, rush. Let's learn what we should have done, what we did well, and let's document, let's get a pipeline going, let's get an assembly line, because we've got a bunch of other acquisitions that are stacking up behind this. So we needed to put in place a repeatable process that we could use that would break down each of the businesses into their capabilities, their applications, their infrastructure, data, security, all sorts of different tags, so to speak. So what we did is we used a modified TOGAF framework. So I customized that so that we could, because if you had to go through and implement every stage of the ADM and produce every deliverable, it would have taken a couple of years per business to do this. So that obviously wasn't going to do it for us. So what I did was instead I created a very high level technical reference model for the infrastructure. So we broke everything down into key areas like messaging, file storage, end user computing, which was things like the hardware that it sat on, the desktop software that we were using, even down to the phones, the communications, the networks, all that stuff. So we broke it down into infrastructure. We broke down into a predefined technical reference model. We were able to send out these TRMs to the various businesses and get them to fill those out. And invariably, there was an extensive discovery process that went on behind that as well. It was really, really key to get the existing enterprise architecture. Because really what we're talking about is instead of kind of taking one business and looking at the current and then looking at the 2B, what we're really doing is we're looking at our own IT landscape. And that was the 2B. Looking at the acquired business was the current architecture. And then obviously creating that migration from one architecture to the other architecture, we use standard TOGAF frameworks. We also used obviously enterprise application architecture modeling tools as well. In this case, as I said here, we're using AddOIT. So we would put all of the assets into AddOIT, classify them, categorize them. That's where the bulk of the discovery happened. We also had to map the business to the IT for the applications. Obviously, then we designed the 2B. A lot of times there are things we had to put in place in order to ensure the target business landed on an appropriate platform. And in order to, once we had the as is and the 2B, we would then generate gaps and we would put that into a requirements model. So if you think of the TOGAF framework, it all centers around the requirements gathering aspect of the ADM. So as we went through, we did our discovery on one hand, we got the as is, we designed our 2B so that they could land effectively on our platform. And then we just compared them and just did a line by line comparison. What are we gonna have to do in order to get from this to this? So for example, if we needed to do a notes migration into Office 365, we would detail all the requirements and that would bring the SMEs in for that and say, listen, what do we have to do in order to get that to happen? Let's put some timelines around that, put a project manager on it and start that off as a work stream, separate work packages for that. We did that for everything from applications to the infrastructure. And then finally, we just generate those tasks based on the requirements, put it into a project and we give it over to a project manager and generally a solution architect. And they would go off and actually do the implementation of it. So the enterprise architecture is more about establishing the process and the tools in order to get this kind of factory assembly line going. So this is a real life example of one of the business capability maps that we did. The organizational units that were involved, and as you can see, this is done on a roadmap capability, one of the nice functions of Auto IT is you can go and you can assign it to a different phase, and you can assign it to a stage of the process. And what you do then is you just click a button and it shows you what's going to disappear and then what's going to appear. So here, this is actually a real life example for what we did for the Luxembourg business. And as you can see, there's an awful lot of duplication of business functions across multiple business units there. So you can see we're going to be streamlining down to three individual businesses from approximately seven. And those are all the business capabilities that we're going to fold into each other. So the key here was being able to map those systems to the infrastructure as well. So you can see you've got a swim line there for each of them. So we could actually trace all the way through, and this is actually quite a simplified version. We have multiple versions. If we'd have done everything on one document, which I tried to do initially, and it was spaghetti junction. It was a really, really incredibly complicated map that nobody could really read. So what we did was we broke them down into different views. So the views for each particular stakeholder. So we knew exactly from the business capability all the way down to the physical server on which these, or virtual server on which these things sat. And once we had that end-to-end view, we were in a much better position to be able to say, okay, this is the impact if we change this system, and here's the impact if we change this system, and to all the relevant stakeholders, from legal to regulatory to the actual person, you know, fund administrator who was doing the work on the ground. So that made it very, very easy. It was developing that discovery and then putting it all into a tool. And then once you plonk those specific things onto the map, everything automatically shows you how it's connected. And sometimes we were very surprised, as you can see over there toward the right-hand side, we were not aware sometimes of the extent to which certain systems, and physical and logical, were involved. And so sometimes there was a hornet's nest that you'd uncover there that you just had to deal with. So that's how we designed the 2B. So you can see the 2B is a lot cleaner now, with much more consolidated and simplified corporate structure, which is very, very nice for the regulator. The regulator likes to see clean corporate structures simplified, because remember, they have to assess all this stuff. And the messier it gets, the less likely they are to approve any of these mergers or acquisitions. Now, this is actually another real life business and tech dependency analysis that we did. So we have at the very top, when we were doing the consolidation of these Luxembourg entities, at the very top of the diagram, you can see this is the goal. This is the objective that we're trying to achieve. And in the second swim lane there, you can see this is the overall program that is going to support that objective. Then we had the initiatives, and those were down to individual projects. Now, as those individual projects were detailed, we realized actually we need to do, there's another sub-project that's linked to that. And then, of course, you can link those sub-projects to individual applications or infrastructure, whatever you want to do, really. The beauty of this diagram is that we've got some red, yellow, and black lines there, or green lines as well, actually. And what that did is we were able to communicate to senior management exactly what the impact of all these projects was. But more specifically to the senior management, they saw the interdependency of all the different applications. Just going to take a quick diversion here and tell you that we were working with one particular architect who was doing some crucial work in one of the areas. We had him on contract. His contract was not renewed because we were under financial pressures at the time. Obviously, when you're buying all of these companies, it takes a toll on your cash flow. So what they started doing was they started cutting certain personnel. And when they took this particular architect off the project that he was doing, nobody really appreciated the implications of doing that until he had left. And then when he had left, this small project in the corner that we thought didn't have too much importance turned out to have a huge effect on a multiplicity of other projects. And we were only able to discover that through this map when people started complaining. Obviously, since he left, there's a ripple effect. There are a lot of people not very happy with that because it impacted their project negatively. So maps like this and these dependency analyses were really, really useful for us. So the management asked me to do up a project dependency diagram, and this is the one that I drew up for them. And we saw how many projects that actually impacted. So I think there were discussions had, and within 3 days he was back in the office again. So luckily he hadn't found anything yet. But this just goes to show you that sometimes when you think a system or a person or a process may not be that important, just having it there in front of you and seeing exactly what the impact is can be really, really crucial. We could have avoided that if the right people had seen this particular diagram. So as you can see, we're planning on decommissioning some systems, moving other clients over to other systems, and it really is a hornet's nest. If you're not careful, it's a real hornet's nest if you don't get all these moving parts right. I like to liken this to, you know, you're on a train and we're literally trying to build the track in front of the train as it's going down the line. So we really, really had to be agile and flexible here. That's about it for me. It's about 35 minutes. I thought we'd leave a little bit more time for discussion, because the last time I did this, we had quite a few questions. We had a lot of very, very good feedback. So I thought I'd open it up to the floor. It's tough doing it over the web like this. It's usually much more interactive, but these are the days that we live in. So I just thought I'd open it up to the floor and ask if there are any questions or any concerns that anybody has.
Thanks, Derek. And also from my side, for everyone who is listening right now, in case you want to share any questions, you can do that directly in the questions panel. Maybe in the meantime, a few things that came to mind as I was also listening to the presentation, Derek, from my side. You mentioned that one of the core M&A challenges is data transfer, naturally. So I wanted to ask if you'd be able to shine a bit more light on what exactly is your approach to data transfer, if you have any particular strategy to prioritizing and sort of sifting through the gigabytes and terabytes of data, deciding what has to be transferred, basically.
Yeah, most of the time what we're doing is we're looking at the types of data. So within this technical reference model, what we do is we split the data into structured and unstructured data. So we look at all the data that's structured in databases. So we have a lot of, obviously, we have financial and accounting information coming from financial packages. We have Oracle Financials, we'll have Financial Force, we'll have, you know, other accounting programs. And then we'd sit down with the finance team and figure out how we're going to map the structured data. That actually is a little bit more, it's a bit easier in some ways, because you have very well-defined, hence the term structured, you have very well-defined fields that you have to move over. So you have, you know, your names, you have your transactions, you have your dates, you know, amounts, things like that. And that's all fairly standard stuff. So usually a couple of workshops, you have all that sorted out. The devil's in the details. It's usually governed more by the M&A contract than anything else, and also by the regulator. So in some instances, we did not need to go back an awful long way. So for example, with the, I believe with the Deutsche Bank merger or acquisition, what we did was we simply agreed that any data beyond a certain date was the property of Deutsche Bank, and beyond this date, it was our data. So that really helps to limit. When you limit it in time, as opposed to by subject or by tag or whatever it is. The unstructured data is usually a little bit more difficult, purely because of the fact that it is unstructured. And I think anybody who's gone onto a corporate drive notices the proliferation of folders and files and permissions, and sometimes the same information is stored in multiple locations. So there are a couple of different approaches that we have for that. A lot of the times what we like to do is we like to do a big bang approach. So what we'll do is we'll take a first cut of all, we'll identify the file systems that need to come over. We'll take a first cut of that data, and we use different technologies to do this replication as well, depending on what our discovery turns up. But we'll take a first cut of that data, and then we'll usually take subsequent deltas. Now, this can be anything from literally getting it on a disk for Deutsche Bank. That's what we had to do. We've put it onto an encrypted disk and physically ran it down via courier to the head office, and we ingested it there. Others, not too bad. We'll use something like Veeam, and we'll do file system replication. And that's obviously much more automated. And then we'll have a cutover date. Usually when the deal is signed, and all the data and clients become apexes, we'll have a team kind of in a war room standing by, and we'll flip the switch. We will do the syncs of data and make sure that it's all there, present it, make sure it has the correct permissions on it. And all this we've done because we've learned through hard experience what we need to do right. So there's a couple of different approaches to that, but generally it comes down to what is required. Sometimes you're not just buying the customer, you're not buying all of their historical data too. And so when you get that and you have terabytes upon terabytes of data, obviously most of the time what we want to try to do is automate that. So we'll send it up into the cloud, we'll get a good thick pipeline in there to make sure that they can transfer it up. Sometimes we use your migration tools that they have there. Sometimes it comes down to physical disks. Sometimes it doesn't. If they're in the cloud already, it's usually quite useful to do cross-tenancy replication, things like that. But most of the time, it's tough. It's the archive stuff that we really have to worry about. Some of them are stored on CAS, so you can't modify them. You just have to take them as blobs. And then others, you have to go back for years and years. And so sometimes you're just physically lifting and shifting a machine as well. It all depends. Each one is different. And that's kind of the fun of this. But at least you have a system whereby you can categorize it.
Perfect. Thanks for that. And I would love to dive deeper into that. But I see we have two more questions right now from some of the participants. The first question is, how do you manage the dependencies between the different applications over different projects?
Yeah, what's useful is if you have a really good enterprise architecture tool, you can deep dive into each of these applications. As you can see here, what we've done is here on this particular slide, what you do is you can define the relationships within the project or within the application itself. So as you're creating that application, there's numerous things that you can connect to it. If they're only communicating by, say, web service, RESTful endpoint or a RESTful API, you model that as an interface, and then you connect both of those applications to that interface. And what that does then is you can generate reports that go off and show you exactly which interfaces are used across which applications. And what's nice about it is that you can drag and drop that interface onto a model, and from your reporting, you can see which applications are connected to it. So you can drag and drop those applications on, and say we drag and drop one, you know, application one and application two. And then we find out as soon as we drop those onto the model, there's a line that connects the two of them directly. You go, oh, hang on, how are those two actually connected? So you can drill down into the model and you can find out exactly how those are directly connected. So you can find, oh, there's actually a database link between both of them. Sometimes it's not actually within that particular component that you're modeling, but at least when you model it out and you've got that core connecting interface, you can see exactly how they're all connected. But generally, the accuracy in that will depend on this, on the degree to which you've discovered the applications. That's really the key part. What you need to do is make sure that you're taking a consistent approach to how you are modeling those applications. So if you decide to model it with an interface and both of the applications connecting to that, that's fine. If, though, you want to directly connect applications as dependencies to each other, that's fine too. One of the main things that I would say to most solution or even enterprise architects that I work with is, I don't mind if we do it wrong, as long as we do it wrong consistently, because it's all about reusability and being able to report on that. And if we decide to change the process by which we do that, we're gonna have to go and update all the artifacts that are affected by that. So the key is consistency. The key is, if you want to model that, you need to be consistent about how you model it so that you can report against it consistently.
I hope we answered this question successfully. Maybe we can move on to the next one.
Sure.
The next question is, does the approach only cover acquisitions where the target systems are always the Apex landscape, or would it also work for a mixed landscape of both current landscapes? So as an example, best of both or best of breed approach?
Yeah, absolutely. No, really, really good question, actually, because we don't always assume that Apex has the best technology there. In fact, the CEO has specifically stated on a couple of occasions, the whole reason we're buying this company is because we like their technology. So that company's technology becomes the target platform. Yeah, it's definitely not always the Apex. Generally, yes, it's the Apex platform. Just as an example, when we did the Warburg acquisition, the reason we did the Warburg acquisition was because when we had bought the Deutsche Bank AFS, Deutsche Bank, because obviously they're a bank, they naturally had a banking platform and they could do something called depository, where you actually hold custody of the assets. Because Apex didn't have a bank, we couldn't hold depository custody of those assets. So when we bought AFS, One of the functions, obviously, the core function that they did was fund accounting and transfer agency. But another key function that they did was custody and depository. But we didn't have a bank, so we couldn't take those functions. So the CEO went off and bought a bank so that we could take those functions. And then what we did is we split it into two different waves. So we took the transfer agency and the fund accounting services. We took those first and we put those onto our own platforms because we had something that we could put them onto. However, because we didn't have the banking platform yet, we had to delay the integration of the custody and depository until what we called wave two. Once we had finalized the deal with Warburg, we got their systems. What we did is we made those systems the target architecture for custody and depository for Deutsche Bank's custody and depository. So that's actually a really, really good question because you've got all of these moving parts. And sometimes what will happen is we'll be given the heads up of an acquisition that's coming down the line. In case we're planning on migrating any clients onto a platform, the CEO could tell us, no, actually we're buying a company and they're going to have the target platform for that. So we'll, you know, put a hold on that. We'll let them operate as is until that acquisition is done. And then we'll do the migration to the target platform once we have the acquisition. So yeah, really good question though. Really good question.
Thanks, Eric. Yeah, one more question here we have. What is the hardest part of the presented integration approach? What takes the most time and what are the lessons learned from executing this particular approach?
The single most difficult thing is having to agree with just, it's actually not the technical part, believe it or not, is actually the easy part. That's actually very easy. It's all the other pieces around it. It's the arguing about who's going to be an MD. It's the arguing about what position they're going to have in the future organization. Who's controlling the finances, who's paying for what, all of that stuff gets into it. That's probably the most time-consuming part. One of the things that I'm working on right now is a revised business model in Luxembourg. And because we had five different entities there, we're consolidating into one entity. And it's just the legal ramifications of what we're doing, the regulatory ramifications. Everybody's got a dog in the hunt, so to speak. And it's actually figuring that stuff out that is the hardest. Because for example, we have five different ways, as I was showing you on there. We have the business capabilities, we have them all mapped out. What we're doing is we're currently going over exactly how, say, IPES does their fund accounting right now. We notice they're using customized squirrely little applications to do these things. And then we find out that we're doing a very, very similar thing on a different platform in Apex. So the question is then, we have to modify the business model. So when we say, okay, we're modifying the operational model of how we're going to be doing this, well, that's going to have a direct impact on the guys who've been doing it for years. And obviously they're used to doing it one way. And so aligning those operational models is probably the most difficult part. And everybody has an opinion on how it should be done. And there's, you know, legal and regulatory implications for exactly how you're going to do that. So that's probably the toughest part. That's probably the toughest part of it, not the technical. The technical is relatively, it's not easy, but it's relatively easy compared to that.
I think one thing that also came up as part of your answer there were the capabilities, right? And I was just thinking, mm-hmm. when you were talking about the Luxembourg merger and the example with the result with the architect whose contract was renewed, but also with respect to the capabilities, you were mentioning how you had the map showing how capabilities were consolidated across different yeah. organizational units. Naturally, keeping things on a higher level, i.e. working with capabilities, can make your life a bit easier whenever you're consolidating such assets. Do you ever find yourself drilling deeper down into the more granular level to sub-capabilities or functions or even processes?
Oh, yeah, yeah. And sorry if I didn't make that clear in this presentation. This is just a high-level overview of how we did that. We absolutely drill down and we have much more detailed diagrams of how the business capability and functions are related, and then which business processes support those capability and functions as well. And sometimes the really clever part of this is defining exactly what a business capability is and how it differs from a business function. We spent probably a half a day talking about that because it impacted our modeling, and we needed to come up with a consistent way of modeling the connection from business process to business function to business capability. And so when we're drilling down on those and obviously using applications at every step of the way, it's a crucial part, because in order to connect from the from the server level all the way up to the business function is a very, very time-consuming thing to do. So you need to make sure that it's consistent and that it brings you value, because if you're just connecting them haphazardly and without much care, the data that you get out of those reports is going to be reflected similarly. It's really tough to do, but it has to be done. You have to sit down with the stakeholders. You have to map out the business processes. In some of the cases, they're there, and it's just a matter of transferring from, you know, a Visio diagram or whatever onto our Atto IT tool, or we just have to sit down with them. We just do it right there in the room. But yeah, absolutely, we have to break it down, and we have to make sure that we know exactly what's going where. We have a really good example of that. I just got off the phone this morning with some people. We have a very customized app. What it does is it scans over the file system, and the file system is structured in such a way as that this application knows which reports are where, how they're named, and where they should be going. So this application goes off and scans these locations and gives a little red, amber, green status for different reports that'll have to go off. So what we had to do was we had to look at the flows of what data there was, what was coming into the application, what was going out to the end clients, and we need to look to see, do we have those same flows somewhere else? What overall business function does this incorporate? And can we replace this with something else? Because we are currently using Zenapp, which is application virtualization, and they're currently using Zen Desktop. So we cannot guarantee that this application is going to work when it goes over to Zenapp. So we need to really drill down into details of how this application works, what information it actually processes it, and what the information flow is on it, so that when this company come into the consolidated Apex entity, they can still function, they can still produce reports. It may be that they have to change the way that they're doing it, but they can still get it done.
Great.
Does that make sense?
It does. It does indeed. And as a final point, I guess also looking at the clock here, but we have a few more minutes. Collaboration is usually a very critical aspect of any EA practice, and I think even more so with very dynamic projects, especially in the M&A cases. So I guess it'll be interesting to find out, how do you tackle that? How do you really collaborate both organizationally and also maybe even in the tool with respect to the various projects that you have, especially if some of them even run in parallel, which I believe should not be unprecedented. And yeah, so basically, how does that work? How does a division of work happen? Is it based on architecture domains or areas of expertise or any other approach?
Yeah, typically what we do is we address it on a per stack basis. So we'll take this. So we usually assign a stack owner to each of those stacks, and they are the SME for that stack. So they know the infrastructure, they know the applications, they know how everything hangs together. Sometimes that's a person within the organization, sometimes it's not. We tried the collaboration part where we open the tool to other people, and that it works, but it only works in certain instances, because we found that, again, going back to consistency, we were getting various levels of consistency when data was being put into the tool. Therefore, we were getting various levels of consistency when we were doing reporting, and we were missing huge chunks sometimes, purely and simply because they were not modeling it the same way that we would have modeled it. So my job in that regard was really to enforce a modeling standard. So it's okay, the collaboration aspect of it is very, very useful, but it's only as useful as the data that you get in. So I found, instead of sitting down with people and just doing a discovery session, we're sitting down with people and saying, this is how we're modeling this, this is how we're modeling it. So what we do is we'd model a few things with them. We'd model maybe the application, the infrastructure, depending on their expertise, and show them why we were modeling it a certain way. And then obviously there's the governance function that we would be performing as well. So we'll look at those models after they've put the data in, and we'll kind of do some fact checking on it. We'll run some key reports, and we'll see, have they tied everything up together? So it's a matter of enforcing the modeling standard more than anything else. The collaboration is absolutely critical, because we need to have that information. We need to get it into the system. We need to know exactly what we have. And sometimes they have a CMDB, sometimes they don't. So most of the time you're looking at somebody having access to the tool and then inputting information into that, but that information isn't always consistent. So our efforts went from doing modeling ourselves to showing them how to model. And then what the benefit of that is, then they can log into the repository, they can update that and go, actually the timeline on this application's changed. We don't have the budget for this. We're gonna need to look to jump to something, you know, rather sooner rather than later. So It can be a real challenge. It can be a real challenge. But the key, again, is consistency in modeling. Collaboration is great and it's super and it's one of the crucial elements here, but it has to be consistent.
Perfect. Thank you, Derek. And yeah, I'm just looking at the clock here. I think we have a couple of minutes left, so let me just take over for now. There's a few final points to discuss. So once again, everyone, thank you for joining today's session. In case you have any follow-up questions or if you would like to discuss some of your own EA use cases and challenges in greater detail, please feel free to reach out to Derek or myself at any time. As mentioned, the recording of today's session will be shared with you as well as the slides. If you're generally also interested in finding out more about AdoIT, about our offerings in general, you can also contact us at the email shown below or check our various online sources as shown at the bottom of the slide. Once again, on behalf of Derek and myself, I would like to thank you for joining today's presentation. Have a great rest of the day and yeah, take care. Goodbye.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.